Today we're going to talk about energy transfers by heating, and we're going to look at the three main methods of energy transfer, and that's conduction, convection, and radiation. Conduction is when vibrations get passed between particles through the bonds that hold them together, and as particles start to vibrate, as they get hot at one end, those vibrations then start to knock on to the particles next to them, and then the particles next to them, and so on, until those vibrations get transmitted throughout the whole of that material. And you can see that moving from right to left, you've got the vibrating particles, some of that energy gets pushed onto the next particle, and you get this spectrum of heat energy from hot to cold. You've all experienced this if you put a metal spoon into a hot drink. Metals are very, very good conductors. They've got densely bonded, closely packed particles, and as the spoon starts to vibrate at the bottom, those energy transfers get pushed up to the handle. Whereas a wooden spoon is a very, very poor conductor because you've got gaps between the fibers and the wood, and therefore not all of those vibrations get pushed along, and therefore wood is a poor conductor. So conduction is between particles. So solids tend to be very, very good conductors because the particles are very closely packed. They're touching, so when they start to vibrate, that has a knock-on effect on the particles surrounding them. Liquids are also very poor conductors because the particles, although touching, they do have gaps between them. And if you fill a bath and it's cold at one end and hot at the other, you know from having to put your hand in to swirl the water around to get the temperature the same everywhere, that it takes a long time for the liquid to conduct the heat from one end to another. And gas particles are very poor conductors because the particles are only very rarely touching each other, and therefore they're not available to pass on their vibrations quickly to the particles that are adjacent to them. So if you have good conductors, you also call that being a poor insulator, and poor insulators let the heat out very, very quickly, whereas a poor conductor is a good insulator and they can trap heat. So metals tend to be very, very good conductors. Plastics and woods tend to be very, very good insulators. The second method of energy transfer is convection. And this is when the particles gain energy and they collide against each other and spread apart. And as they spread apart, liquids and gases, they can expand. And then because they're less dense, they will rise upwards, while the cooler and the denser fluids, which have lost the energy and are coming back together again, they will sink back down. And you get what you call a convection current. So you can see that the less dense particles, they will move apart and float upwards, and the cooler, denser particles will sink, and you get this cycle of up and down, becoming a circular current. And we can see this in the examples that I've got here. So for the pan of water on a stove, you've got the water bubbling up, it gets heated from the bottom, and then it transfers to the top and then gets pushed down the sides again as it cools away from the flame, and then it gets heated again and it goes back up to the top. The earth, the winds are all driven by convection currents as they get heated by different amounts by the sun. Then as the air expands in one area, it will rise up and then it will sink back down again, and it will produce all of these typical wind patterns that we see. Below the earth's surface, you've got the lava bubbling away, and again, as it gets heated, it expands, it rises to the surface, and you get convection currents in the mantle, and that can then hit the crust and create earthquakes. And hot air balloons, again, they fly by convection. As the particles inside get heated, they spread out and become less dense, and therefore the hot air balloon rises. And if the pilot wants to bring it back down, he'll just let it gently cool, and then they'll gently float back down to earth. So that is convection. And then finally is radiation. And if you heat metal bars and you see from the right hand side, they're starting to glow with a very, very dull red. And then as they get hotter, that duller red becomes bright orange and then yellow and then white. You can see that they're very, very, very hot at the left hand side of those two metal bars. But before that, where it's black, they're still radiating energy. They'd still be hot to the touch. And if you put your hand close to them, you will still feel heat coming off those. But the wavelengths are now too long for us to see. We can only see wavelengths that stop at red. So beyond red or infrared, we can't see those longer wavelengths, but they're still there. And that's what we experience as heat. Both visible light and infrared are part of the electromagnetic spectrum, which means they can travel through air or a vacuum like space at the speed of light. And we know this because when the sun comes up in the morning, you both see the sun and feel its heat at the same time. The visible light radiation is a shorter wavelength that our eyes can detect. The infrared radiation is too long for our eyes to detect, but we can feel it as heat all the same. And if you get special sensors which can see those, you can see in the images for the Earth, you've got all of the warmer regions around the equator radiating heat, and the pole, the Canada, the North Pole that you can see, that's much colder, and therefore it's not radiating quite so much. And with the picture of the lady, where her skin is exposed, it's 37 degrees Celsius, it's going to be radiating heat, but where she's got her hair piled up, it's going to be insulating the heat, acting as a barrier, and therefore that part of her head appears to be cooler. And for radiation, you need to know also that colors can affect radiation. If you have a shiny white surface, it's a very, very poor radiator. And if you look at the thermometer next to the black surface, it's much higher because they radiate more heat than white. And you can see this for yourself. If you put water from the same kettle into a white mug and into a black mug, the black tea or coffee will cool down much quicker than the white tea or coffee in the white mug. Okay, so those are your three methods of heat transfer: conduction, where particles vibrate, and therefore for the kettle, it's going to be the handle that will feel hot because it's attached to the solid part of the kettle. Convection, where you get those currents of circular up and down to do with density, driven by the currents that you can see in the water and in the steam. And then the radiation is the infrared. It's the heat you can feel if you stand too close to the gas flame below the kettle. You need to know those three methods. Think about the particles, think about what they're doing for conduction and for convection. And for radiation, don't forget there aren't any particles. It's all about electromagnetic waves radiating at the speed of light. Thank you.